John chapter 1. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him, about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you come to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The word of the Lord. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on these words, on our hearts, and on our lives today. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Miriam Foltz, and I am pastor of UKirk St. Louis. UKirk, or University Church, is a new campus ministry of this presbytery, serving students at Washington University, St. Louis Universities, and really all other universities in this area. Housed at Trinity Presbyterian Church in University City, just up the road, UKirk is where students can worship and follow Christ by serving others, explore and learn about faith, and encounter God's love. Starting in exactly 3 weeks, UKirk will gather during the school year on Sunday evenings for a time of worship, fellowship, and food, in a similar style to first century house church gatherings. UKirk officially began this past January, and during the ministry's first semester, students gathered for small group Bible studies, worship, and food. Over these past 8 months, I have been busy connecting with and inviting students to get involved with this faith community. At the end of April, we celebrated the conclusion of the school year with an ecumenical picnic and worship service. The Episcopal, Lutheran, and Presbyterian campus ministries gathered together over a meal, deemed the first annual Luther-Presbyterian cookout. Over 30 students lounged in picnic chairs and on blankets in front of the Lutheran Campus Ministry House on Forsyth, and the students reflected on how their semesters were wrapping up, how their summer plans were coming along, and for those about to graduate, their hopes and their fears for the future. As the sun went down, we moved into a time of worship. Having eaten together, we sang together, prayed together, and broke bread together, proclaiming the saving death and resurrection of Christ. And after the service had concluded, it turned out that worship was just beginning. Around a campfire, students passed out songbooks, picked up guitars, and kept singing. And they sang, "We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord." It was powerful. Into an academic environment where too many consider faith and higher education to be incompatible, these students said, "We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord." They sang out with boldness, with joy, with conviction, students across many backgrounds, some lifelong Christians, others new to the faith, sang together. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. Into a culture where being Christian is often associated with judgment and hypocrisy, they sang of God's love, witnessing to their faith together. Sing with me. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. around a campfire, these young adults sang prophetically, using words that are just as relevant today as they were 5 decades ago when they were written. We are one in the Spirit. These words we will sing together later in this service, were put to music by a Catholic priest in the South Side of Chicago during the Civil Rights Movement. It was written for a youth choir to sing at ecumenical interracial events, and it's a hymn that still desperately needs to be sung today. The song reminds us of how God calls us to be in this world, working together and walking alongside one another in God's own love. The song also reminds us that we, the church, often fail to live into that calling. For too many Christians, church is the last place where racial and economic disparities in our country are discussed. Church has become a place to worship God with blinders on, blocking out the pain and suffering in the world. Conversations about race, poverty, and gun violence can be difficult and uncomfortable. And no matter where we fall in the equation of injustice, God's justice can seem like it's light years away. But God keeps calling us anyway. God keeps calling us into faithful and honest community with one another. Students have been excited for this university church, for opportunities to serve and study scripture, to worship Christ, to have these conversations about how faith in Christ and seeking justice are interconnected. As I have invited students and encouraged them to invite one another to become a part of this community, I've come to realize that the challenges to young adults' embodiment of their faith is similar to the challenges facing most generations of the church today. Being a part of UKIRK or any church community takes time, energy, and the willingness to be open and vulnerable as we share, learn, and grow in our faith in Christ. Understanding and living out one's faith is hard work, but by doing it together, we might just be able to proclaim the gospel. Our neighbors might just know that we're Christians by our love. In today's gospel reading, we hear Philip announcing to Nathanael that they have found the Messiah. And Nathanael's response is tongue-in-cheek. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? It's skeptical, judgmental, doubtful. The question has several layers to it. For in John's gospel, Jesus is not from Nazareth. Jesus is of God. So from ours, the reader's perspective, John is signaling to us that Nathanael is misinformed. But we should also ask, what's wrong with Nazareth anyway? Nathanael's snobbery about this country town reveals his own prejudices and assumptions. It reveals the divisions within ancient Israel along economic and social lines. It reminds us that human divisions and stereotypes are not a new phenomenon. But Philip does not give up. He does not write Nathanael off as a hopeless skeptic or a cynic. But neither does Philip justify the question or validate his opinion by fumbling for an easy answer or explanation. Philip simply replies, "Come and see." Philip witnesses that a faithful response to doubt, skepticism, and misconceptions is to shine Christ's light into the darkness. Philip extends Christ's radical invitation to Nathanael, inviting him to become a part of the story of God. Nathanael has the opportunity to move from being a sideline observer to becoming an active participant in following Christ. Philip's response proclaims that even when in the midst of our own doubts and unfounded convictions, God's radical hospitality is actively reaching out and inviting us into a relationship with God and with one another. Christ's radical love and hospitality welcomed in Nathanael even before Philip invited him to Christ. And Nathanael will get to witness that hospitality, that grace in action. For the very next verses in John, Jesus and his group of disciples, which we can only assume includes Nathanael and Philip, attend the wedding at Cana, and they witness Christ's transformation of water into wine. Out of scarcity, Jesus creates abundance and affirms the holy hospitality that is central to the kingdom of God. Come and see. On this Sunday, we get to hear the good news proclaimed at Christ's table. In Christ's life, death, and resurrection, we are promised a new freedom. Freedom from death, from fear, from sin. A freedom that breaks down cynicism and skepticism and prejudices, even through a simple invitation. Come and see. It's a freedom that transforms us into a deeper connectivity to one another and to God. We become one in God's Spirit. We, the church, are witnesses to the ultimate invitation, to come and see what Christ has done, is doing, and will do in this world, to come and experience a radical hospitality that transforms our lives and shapes our understanding of the world in which we live. In and through our questions and doubts, the Holy Spirit moves us and shapes our everyday relationships into a holy community. Eucharist gathered on Maundy Thursday this last semester to celebrate the Last Supper through a Seder meal. We gathered with the Lutheran Campus Ministry to break bread together, and around 16 young adults gathered family style around two large tables. And it was a family meal. We read the story of Exodus together, we ate a full meal together, and students shared stories about their days. Similar to any good family reunion, they retold funny stories. And at the end of the gathering, we asked the students what it was like to read the story of Exodus using the Passover liturgy. And their responses were profound. They shared how moving it was to taste the bitter herbs while reflecting on the Israelites' suffering. They talked about what it was like to participate in the remembering and in the celebration while sitting at a table with one another, just as Christ sat at table with his disciples. Many Newkirk students have shared about the challenge of being a person of faith in today's world. In a pluralistic culture, religious dialogue is very important, but when one doesn't have a supportive community of faith, or when one isn't entirely sure what one believes, religious dialogue can be difficult, frustrating, and lead to even more misunderstanding. Further, one student shared how the majority of her friends are atheists or agnostic, with their understanding of Christianity and religion in general based on stereotypes from popular culture. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Nathaniel's question echoes in various refrains today. Can anything good come out of the church? For following Christ. Across the centuries, God resounds with yes. Throughout creation, the Spirit of God has moved in the formation and creation of the world and through the redeeming and reconciling works of Jesus Christ and his church. As Christ invites us all, Eucharist strives to invite students to be the church, to know and follow Christ, what it means to worship the one true living God, and to be able to share with others what they believe. Through their words and their actions, students might even then be able to invite others to come and see. In the tradition of the Presbyterian Church, Eucharist calls young adults to embody their faith, to bring their full knowledge and understanding when they come to worship, and to carry their faith with them, whether they are in the classroom or heading off to work. The Spirit's power to witness drives the church into the world, to show that we are Christians by our love, to proclaim our freedom in Christ from the powers of evil and sin, as we seek reconciliation across barriers and divisions. My prayer for Eucharist college students is my prayer for Christians across the generations. May we keep learning and exploring the stories of our faith throughout our lives, seeking Christ who knows us and invites us before we ever RSVP. Amen. and the words of our next hymn. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, God's only Son, and all praise to the Spirit, who makes us one.